approximating the posterior. So like the executive summary is like, this chapter is about grid approximation, Markov chain Monte Carlo, and MCMC, Markov chain Monte Carlo diagnostics. So yeah, I mean, essentially grid approximation is that you just throw out a net, like a wide range of values, and you calculate the posterior density for each one of those values for your parameter, and then you get a distribution in the end. So it's sort of like if you have computer science experience, it's sort of like a brute force search, like searching through. I mean, of course you can do a grid that is not like, you know, the full grid, like full parameter space, but okay. And then Markov chain Monte Carlo is that you can probabilistically approximate the posterior, and what they show in the chapter is that they use RStan. And then in RStan, or like in STAN actually, I mean, RStan is an R wrapper on top of STAN. You define the data, the parameters, and the model, and then you just sort of run it, and RStan automatically handles the rest. And the way it's like, I mean, Markov chain is sort of like, you know, the current value depends on n number of previous values. So I mean, at first, I think, yeah, now the translation, like, I think it's called first degree Markov chain, relies on the previous step and then first order, I think. I could be wrong with the wording there. So like first order Markov chain, you rely on one step back. Second order Markov chain, you'd rely on one and two step backs. And you could, of course, do a lag, so you like only rely on three steps back, but not two and one, I guess.
Okay.
But that's sort of like, I mean, that's like mathematically what a Markov chain is. So sort of like, the weather today will predict the weather tomorrow, but the weather yesterday doesn't matter. So that's sort of like, yeah, pretty much. And then Monte Carlo means that it's a probabilistic algorithm. And then we're going to go into diagnosing Markov chain Monte Carlo. So essentially you just want, so I guess this is left to right for you. You want a good Markov chain to just oscillate up and down, sort of like if you looked at white noise at some point. So like just oscillate up and down, and you don't want any trend in there. There's a few other stuff, like there's a little autocorrelation, but like trending up and down against, like, you know, a fixed sort of mean, that sort of means there's low autocorrelation. They talk about effective sample sizes. We'll talk a bit more about that, but sort of essentially, since it's a chain, you're sampling like one step in the chain depends on the previous step, then the samples are not independent, right? There is a dependency. So if the effective sample size is 20%, it sort of means that look at all the values from the iteration in the Markov chain corresponds to like 20% as many independent samples. And they also talk about R hat, but we have an equation for that later. So but essentially like R hat that is not too big means that you, like when you do run the Markov chains, you run more than one, you actually run a few of them, and you don't want them to diverge too much. You want them to be sort of similar. So essentially like a low R hat means that multiple independent Markov chains look similar. Are we good with the executive summary?
Yeah, I think I didn't realize, like, because in JAGS, another like jib sampler like that do Markov chain Monte Carlo, you do pruning. Like you specify, like let's say like you, a Markov chain is basically a random walk, and you removed like, because you have autocorrelation, you prune some value, like let's say one out of two to not get that. But I didn't know that Stan was doing it also, so. That's good. I learned something.
Yeah. Let's double check how Stan does it, because I mean, I could have gotten something wrong as well, of course.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, but I think it does, but I think you are right. But I didn't realize it.
Okay. Next step. So grid approximation, the first step. So grid approximation, like we'd like to summarize it, is the brute force search of the parameter space using discrete values for the parameter of interest. So they have an example from the book. I I decorated the example a bit, but let's assume that Michael Jordan, he throws 10 shots and he scores 9, or like back in the 90s when he was pretty much king of the world. You remember, right, Olivier? I'm suspecting I prefer the term enjoying my best years than being old, but let's not dive too much into the details. But anyways, it's like Michael Jordan scores 9 out of 10 shots. What's our best estimate on his capability to score? So we can set like a prior. And let's just assume that whoever sets this prior did not enjoy the documentary, The Last Dance. I have friends who they really don't, they don't like Michael Jordan. And it's just like, you know, like cracking down. Oh, the level was so low. The league wasn't good. The defenders were crap. But I mean, like, you know, best in the world so many years in a row is still best in the world so many years in a row. Like, it's a lot of people who were not the best in the world during the 90s, not a single time. They were still great athletes. So, but let's just assume that we have like, you know, this equal probability on shoot to miss, like data 2-2 prior, because it's one of my basket loving, non-Michael Jordan loving friends who set the prior. And then we can just like, you know, throw out the grid for all values between 0 and 1. That's like the Michael Jordan's true probability to score. So we know that the data is like 9 out of 10, or like 10 successes in 10 trials. And the prior comes from a beta 2-2 distribution.
So it's a symmetric one.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then y conditioned on pi comes from the distribution, like the binomial distribution of 10 shots we have pi successes. Or like we have a success, 10 shots we have a success rate of pi. So essentially, what we can do in R is that we can just list all the values between 0 and 1. So, I mean, we can do this with this command, like P, we set the sequence from 0, 1 by 0.x, like whatever precision we want, like 0.1 or 0.01 or whatever. And then, like, and we can set the prior for each of one of those to calculate the prior for each of those pi's, the beta 2-2. And then we can get the likelihood for each prior, like this. I'm writing prior here. I'm wondering if I messed up the lingo a bit. So the unnormalized posterior would be prior times likelihood, and we can divide by the sum of the prior times likelihood to get the full distribution. So sort of list all the values, get the prior probability, like get a value for the prior given that we assume 2-2 for this underlying success probability. Multiply by the likelihood of scoring 9 out of 10, given that we have the same pi. And you do that for all the grid of pi's. And then you get like a posterior, but it's not normalized. You need to normalize it. And normalizing it is just like we want it to be between 0 and 1. So we just
The trick is like the distribution beta and binomial are vectorized, I assume. So they take like an input that's go like from probably 0. Well, they do all the possibility of pi by which will be like, let's say 0.1 will be like something like 9 or 10 possibilities, and they draw the beta by each in these possibilities. Yes, it's okay.
Yeah, let's look at how it can look in codes. Let's focus on the upper left here. I always, no, I don't always. Most of the time I start my analysis by this like RM list equals LS, like essentially delete all the objects you have in your environment, which is like super important thing for reproducibility. Like, I don't know how many times I've seen analysis, like someone has an analysis on GitHub, you pull it down and it just doesn't work. Like, you don't get the same values as they did because they did one of the operations, they did it more than once. And then it's just like, doesn't work. So we can see pi candidates, we said it becomes a vector from 0 to 1 by 0, 1. And then our prior vector, we say like for each p candidate, like how likely are we to see 2-2 given the p candidate? So that's prior probability given the pi candidate. So the likelihood, 9 out of 10 for pi candidates, 9 success out of 10 trials for the pi candidate probability. And then we take prior times likelihood. we get the unnormalized posterior, and then we can take the unnormalized posterior and divide it by the sum of the value, and then we get a posterior where all values are between 0 and 1. So I sort of explained the same thing in words before and now by code, but did the explanation make any sense, how we can go about a grid approximation, or was it just like technical Greek coming out of my mouth?
No, it's a grid, because like it's like you, the grid is like the pike, the sequence. You are like generating the grid by generating the sequence.
Exactly. It's like that's why I call it a brute force search. Like here, you know, we have steps of 0, 1, so that's the precision we get, and we get sort of this like, you know, coarse approximation of the posterior, but we can of course set like, you know, set it to 0, 0, 1, and then we'd get like a much finer approximation, and we can get it. I mean, in theory, we can get it infinitely fine precision. Not in practice though, because of computers and stuff. But it's expensive to do it. Like you need to calculate all the values. And I mean, calculating it from like 0 to 0.4, that's a lot of, you don't really chop down trees for energy, or maybe you do, I don't know how, you, a lot of coal that needs to be harvested out of the mountains to calculate the 0.0 to 0.4 for nothing. And that would be a shame. And the thing, what I really encourage you to do, I guess I'm posting the slides as, I wanted to download them as Markdown, but you can't download Google Slides as Markdown. Didn't find a good plugin for it either, but I really encourage you to do the same example and switch out the prior to a normal prior. So I mean, we have been working with conjugate priors before, and then sort of like, or I guess you did last week without me, but then sort of the prior and the likelihood, they need to come from the same family. Otherwise you can't do this like analytical trickery to make everything work together. But now, I mean, this is just throwing like the good stuff, like, you know, approximations and numerical methods and all that juicy things added. So you can have whatever prior. And then of course, if you put in like a stupid prior that doesn't make sense, then the posterior is going to be like, look like scheisse. But I mean, that's the game, sort of, right? You need to have a decent prior, or it's not going to work. But you can really put like, you know, a norm prior, like a zero mean, one standard deviation normal prior. Works out. And if you have like enough samples from it, it's actually going to give you a good estimate anyways. Okay. So we're going through like grid approximation, essentially like list all the candidates, given whatever, like, you know, prior you assume, like how likely are we to see like each candidate, given like what is the prior for each candidate, and then given the data, what's the likelihood for each candidate, just multiply the two together, normalize it, so we get like values between 0 and 1 for every value, and we're good. Does it feel okay? Do you feel like you could replicate this?
Sure. I was a bit surprised. I would have assumed like the 0.9 will be like the highest points, but it's probably because like the beta, I haven't checked what's the beta 2.2 look like. Because like,
I mean, a beta 2.2 is essentially like it's equal possibility to hit and miss, right?
Yeah.
So, okay. So the 0.9 should be dragged a bit to the left.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But I mean, the 0.9 is the second highest. So, So I mean, Michael Jordan is somewhat decent according to the posterior.
I'm pretty sure it's better.
Yeah. Okay, move on.
Yeah.
Does it feel good with the section? Okay, nice. So MCMC, Markov chain, Monte Carlo, and RStan. So I'm going to talk a bit. And by the way, before I said I was going to move on and then I don't. Shame on me. Like they're using dplyr when they do the example, but like, I mean, just using base R, you have fewer lines of code and it's just easier to understand. So they do a beta binomial example, and then it's the gamma prior with a Poisson count example as well, doing the same, like grid approximation in the book. The example is going to look a little bit different, but it's essentially the same thing. And I really wish they would have shown that you can do it with, like, you know, it doesn't have to be a congregate family prior, because that sort of fools you back into this congregate family thinking, which is analytical patient stats and not MCMC thinking. Okay, more conversation Monte Carlo and or Stan. Okay, so I will cover in the beginning a part that is not, this is not part of the book. It's just like, you know, I added it because I think it makes sense to explain it. Otherwise, some other things don't make sense in my mind. But essentially, Monte Carlo algorithm, like if you study computer science, a Monte Carlo algorithm is just a probabilistic algorithm. And it could be anything that's probabilistic. Markov chain Monte Carlo means that it's probabilistic, but that the, as we discussed before, like the current iteration depends on the previous or various previous iterations. So an example of a Monte Carlo algorithm is that, I don't know if you remember the high school geometry. It's definitely challenging for me to remember high school geometry quite often these days. But sort of like, if you think that you have a square, inside the square you draw a circle, and then if you take the area of the circle and you divide it by the area of the square, you remember those math formulas. You're gonna have to do it on your own time if you if you want to do it. You see that the relationship between the circle and the square is pi divided by 4. So sort of like pi is 3.14, you divide by 4. Like if you imagine what it looks like, I actually have a wallpaper that looks like a circle inside a square now that I think about it. But sort of, yeah, you know, like the circle has less area, it makes sort of sense. So what you can do is that you could just like, imagine that you're standing on the beach in Monte Carlo, like right next to the Monte Carlo casino, and you ran out of money, and you can just draw a square and then you draw a circle inside it and you start to throw like pebbles. And let's just assume that, you know, the placement of the pebble inside the circle or the square is random. And then you can just divide the amount of pebbles inside the circle by all the pebbles or the pebbles inside the square. And then you get this like approximation of pi, like pi divided by 4. So that's an example of a Monte Carlo algorithm. Like there are many more examples. But then you can do Markov chain Monte Carlo. So imagine that you have the same thing. If you try this, you can do it in code. It's like you need to do a lot, you need to throw a lot of pebbles and you still get a shitty approximation of pies. Like this Monte Carlo example, it's a really bad way to approximate pi. You need a lot of iterations. So something that from what I've heard, I didn't find a good example of it online, but I remember it from a previous Coursera course on MCMC, is that you can, instead of throwing the pebble inside the square of the circle and then throw another pebble, you go to the place where the pebble stands and you throw it again inside the square. And if you throw outside the square, you just throw again until you're inside. And then you just go to the next place where the pebble landed and you keep throwing. So you sort of, if you imagine like the zoom screen is like, you know, the square, you just walk around and you throw the pebble again and again and again. And you still take, you know, this, you divide the amount of pebbles that landed inside the circle by the ones inside the square, you actually get a better approximation of pi. So the example makes sense, like how you throw the pebble in step two. Like you throw it inside, you throw it once inside the square, and then you just throw it again, and you go to the point where it landed inside the square. And if you miss outside the square, you just throw it again until you're inside. And then you walk around sort of where the pebble lands. Did it make any sense?
Yeah, I think. I don't know, Brendan.
Do we have? Is it? How do you? Can? Are we able to draw in Zoom? Is there an app for it, or how do we?
Can we just? No. I think John didn't like. Only John can do it. There is whiteboard below on the right. You can try it, but I think
whiteboard.
Like,
where is it?
Yeah.
How do I find
it?
Sorry.
Like you know where is share screen, record everything. This is on my right. And you have whiteboard.
Open have collaborate. Like... Wow.
Wow, it works also.
So the second, and you see my amazing drawing skills. Like, why do I work with gaming analytics? Why am I not a game artist?
It's look like a square.
So much unlocked potential. Okay, so imagine we throw a pebble here.
Yeah.
And then we stand here, and then we throw the pebble again, and it lands here. Then we walk there, And then we're standing here. So let's say we throw the pebble and it lands here. Then we walk there. And then we throw the pebble again and it lands here. And then we walk there. And then we just keep like throwing the pebble and walking to wherever the pebble lands. And we just need to record like how many were inside the circle, how many were inside the square. And that way we can sort of approximate pi. Does the algorithm make sense now?
Okay, now it's beginning to make more sense, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, this was a much better example. Like, so much easier to show. Now, let's see. Let's close the whiteboard. So that's an example of a Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithm, because each step, it's sort of, each iteration, the value you get, it depends on the previous one, because that's the starting point where you throw at. So like that example was not in the book, but I just wanted to give an intuition of like Markov chain Monte Carlo. So yeah, like, as you can see, each step in the Markov chain Monte Carlo is not independent, as it depends on the previous step. And what they write in the book, it's sort of like, you know, like MCMC simulation produces a chain of n dependent theta values, theta 1 to 2 up until n, which are not drawn from the posterior probability density function f theta given y. Like, I mean, yeah, sure, this is true, but it doesn't give you a lot of intuition. But did the Monte Carlo and Markov chain Monte Carlo examples make sense?
Yeah, I usually prefer like the random walk, but that's the same. Like, you are basically walking like, let's say like you are in the middle of, like you are in the middle of a field, and then you either go right or left, and the position and the probability of going right or left depend on the previous position. This is a typical random walk example, like, which is a Markov chain, and it's Monte Carlo because like you, but the example you give is, it's the same idea. Like the, you are like basically like as a, well, you just had, I usually conceptualize just in 1D space, but it works also in 2D spaces and probably like N spaces. You can just conceptualize like as moving like that, like, and yeah, that's fine.
Okay, Olivier gives the pass. I hope I get a pass from you too, brother.
Yeah, for me, it was good. Like, I mean, you can, I think like it's fairly easy to design the Metropolis one. I will check.
Yeah, that's chapter 7, actually. Like, oh, okay. They describe them.
So yeah, I think it's easy. Like when you are like writing the algorithm from scratch, which is like probably just 10 line or maybe less line of codes. And you understand like why it's so.
Right, yeah. I guess one question I have about the example is that I get how it illustrates the Markov chain part, because wherever you throw it, you know, you go to that location. But in this example, wouldn't you be able to approximate the area well just by dropping it randomly?
I did a bad job of explaining. You're actually not approximating the area. You just approximate the pi.
Pi.
Because it's the relationship between the area of the circle and the area of the square. So like if you take right. those formulas, like the formula for the area of the square is PR squared, and then the formula for the and in this case, like 2R would be the side, since R is the diagonal. So it's 2R, and you square all of that, that's 4R squared. So the R squares cancel out, and you have P divided by 4 is left. I said you would have to look at it on your own. Now I said it. Second shame on
you. You spotted us.
Yeah, exactly. But that's how you can approximate pi. So you're not approximating the area, but if you somehow mathematically
if you
can keep track,
you're...
like
yeah.
So it's, yeah, you can.
Okay.
Let's move to the next slide then. So a style model consists of specifying data parameters and the model itself. And this is just completely taken from the book. So I think this is the beta binomial model. So they say that y can go from 0 to 10. I guess that's how they say it. That's how the data can look like. they specify the data lower must be lower boundary and upper must be upper boundary.
And it's they didn't give.
I haven't read all the span manual, but this is the example this state, and they define the parameters. So you have pi, which apparently can go between 0 and 1, I guess.
Yeah.
And then you define the model, so y, it comes from binomial family. 10th rows, probability pi. Okay, 10th rows and with the probability pi, and then the y value is the value you get. So for example, if you just do like one iteration, I guess y would be 9 here. So 9 is an outcome of a binomial model where you threw 10 times and pi is a parameter. And we know that pi comes from the beta 2-2 family.
Yeah, why is the data? And we just have one row. I mean, we just know we just have one point of data. So it's just like we have just one y.
In the previous example. But I guess you could do it in an example where you would have 10,000 different values of y.
Yeah, you will need a loop somewhere, I think.
No, I think the model handles that. I don't think you need a loop.
Okay.
I just think that y can be a vector.
Okay.
I haven't played enough with Stan to be sure.
Yeah, me neither.
And then, but okay, let's not think too much. Like, does the model part make sense of like defining data parameters and the model?
Yeah.
Like when it comes to y, it could be, I guess, any values. It could be like, you know, I guess it could be continuous values as well. If you have a continuous distribution. So I guess y could be, I don't know, like people's body weights in like pounds with like 4 decimal digits or something. And then I guess you would have to define that sort of like lower is probably 0. And I don't know, what would upper be to do approximate people's weight in pounds, like 1,000 pounds, just to be safe.
And everything is defined. So y is defined and p is defined. Then you use y, then you use p.
Exactly. You define like which range of values pi can take.
Yeah.
And in the case of binomial probability, it's 0 to 1. But I guess like if we want to see the effect of, I mean, let's just imagine that y is our people's weights. Now thinking about it, I would probably set it to 0 to 2,000 or 3,000 just to be sure. And then let's say that, I don't know, like pi is the parameter of, I don't know, like.
It's the skill of Michael Jordan, I think.
I mean, in this example, sure, but I mean, in the example, like if you want to see the impact, for example, drinking soda has on body weight, and if the body weight goes from 0 to 3,000 pounds, I guess pi should be continuous then from, maybe the same range. I'm just thinking here, and then the model would probably be like a normal model instead of binomial. It probably would have another parameter which is the standard deviation, as well as the mean, or something. No, not like. Let me think. Yeah, I guess this one could be, okay. I'm making it complicated, try to give an intuition, but essentially like, y is the data, our range, pi is the parameters range, which we played mainly. So I guess, I guess if it's like, you know, this, you could just as well be, the data is like how many sales calls do you receive in a day? That's a better example. And then it's somewhere between 0 and 1,000. And maybe then, would be a parameter lambda instead of pi. That is also like a range, 0 to 1,000, I guess. And then y would be a Poisson model. And then it would just have the parameter lambda, and lambda would come from some gamma distribution. Just to change it around a bit to make, that would make sense, right?
Yeah, I think. Yeah. Depend of the distribution of the cells, but yeah.
Am I making things clear, Brendan, or am I confusing you more with the explanation?
No, I think I got the gist of it. You're good.
Okay. Good to know. And then like in step 2, this once again, like straight from the book. So for the binomial model, they say that, you know, you pass the stan, you pass the model code, so specify the model is the one we specified on the left. In this case, you just have one y value, which is 9. They specify the amount of Markov chains they want to run. In this case, they specify 2 chains. And you can have you can fixate the number of iterations in the chain, apparently. So they fixate it to 10,000.
Yeah.
And then maybe I need to read the book again, but why would you write it 5,000 times two? Like, why don't you write 10,000?
Maybe they are burning 5,000. I don't know. Maybe you have a burning phase. I'm not sure.
Maybe 5,000 is burning and 5,000 is the actual thing. Maybe that's why 5,000 times
I haven't read it, but this is just hypothesis. Probably it can be wrong because it's a lot like to burn half, especially for a simple model.
Yeah. And I guess like seed is just like to keep it reproducible.
Random
get
seed.
The same,
yeah.
Get the same results specifying the seed again. So I guess in the Poisson example, we would change for the model code for the Poisson model, where y is a wider range. We have a parameter lambda that has a wider range of real numbers. And it's a Poisson model with lambda, and lambda comes from some gamma distribution with parameters. And then I guess we could have different data where someone lists all the sales costs they get in one day, chains. I'm wondering if this is like an old school thing for, because
running four chains here.
But I'm just thinking like how many, like I'm thinking this is like Bayesian statistics, which means that you probably run it on your local computer and not in the cloud. And then like how many cores does a normal laptop have these days? Or like normal, I guess you run it on your work laptops. Like how many cores does a work laptop have? Not a lot of work laptops have like 8 cores or something. So you'd probably want to do like 6 chains or something, since you probably get it for free. Like if you can parallelize it and have one per core.
I think you can specify, I think the number of chain can be dependent or independent of the number of threads you use. So I think you can also specify the number of thread. So I don't think the number of chain is related to the number, but it can be wrong to the number of core you use. I think it can be, I think like obviously if you are just one chain, because what the number of chain you want to see is convergence. Do all the chain are the same? So at least you need two. And I think 3 is better. And I think like 4 is just like more insurance.
For sure. But I'm just thinking like if you have, you probably have like at least if you have 8 cores in your processor on your laptop, if you have a fancy MacBook or something, then I'm guessing you probably have 6 to spare. You might as well throw 6 at it. Since it's just like, so if you can run one chain per core, so you sort of, it should be more or less like the overhead from managing more chains should be so little from running compared to running the chains.
Good question. I don't have answer, but I think like at least you need 2 because like you want to see if it's the simulation is going wild or not. And then why double it? I don't know.
Okay. Okay. So this is it. Let's move on.
I have just a question because I haven't read it. Do you know like if I never use Stan inside of RStudio? I use it in Emac, and in Emac you have like a plugin. So you have like a nice auto completion and stuff like that. And do you know? It's look like it's just text, no?
Yeah, the model is always just text. So it's a model string.
There is some tools that offer auto completion on Stan model. So you fail. I mean, you fail. It's less painful on big model, but okay. So it was full text. Okay.
That's my understanding of that. But I do agree with you that. As string as the model can be painful. I'm realizing we have 10 minutes left. I think if we're going to do the presentation at the same pace, I think it's going to take more than 10 minutes. Should I speed things up or should we go?
Go your time and we will stop when you can. It's fine.
Okay. I can go a bit over, but I don't want to force anyone to stay longer than after 9. So
I'm good. I'm good now.
Okay. What about you, Brendan?
Brendan, you say. Yeah, you'll say.
Yeah, I'm good if you go at your own pace. And even if we need to carry into next week, that's okay with me.
Not next week.
Probably like going a bit after 9 rather than, I don't think I want to promise next week.
Right. Okay. And it's recorded sure anyways. Yeah.
Okay. So okay. Okay. Yeah. Then you can watch that double spit. okay. So a stun mold has burn-in, which means that the first N iteration values are thrown away. Talked about that before. And there's this command mcmc trace, which shows you to the trace plot, and you want to make sure that the Markov chain behaves like white noise. So like essentially, it goes up and down, and doesn't get stuck anywhere locally. So this is an example of a healthy looking trace plot. And then let's see. Yeah, exactly. So healthy looking trace plot, and you can use the commands mcmc histograms or mcmc dense on what comes out of the model to explore the posterior estimates that you get from the Markov chain. Those are a bit of commands, but I guess, yeah, like just remember them or remember where to find them in the book and play with them when you start doing modeling. So over to diagnostics. And in like, we looked at one example here, which is once again, like the beta binomial model, and they're doing the gamma Poisson model in the book as well. So there's one more very similar example. Okay, so Markov chain diagnostics. Okay, so a good trend oscillates up and down like white noise with no trend, since trend means autocorrelation. So I guess the question would be, which one of these, like which plot is good, like number one, two, or three, or like which ones are good and which ones are bad and why?
I will go with the top one and bottom one. And then if the bottom one probably like spend too much time computing small stuff. Like I think the plots that go like that, stuff like it's totally trending. So it's totally like suffering from non-stationarity. It will stop maybe at one times, but we don't know when. And it hasn't stopped. So either it should be more burn or you should like maybe do more iteration until it reach stationarity, I think. I don't know if it's a correct word.
And yeah, stationarity.
I think like the chain B like can be good because like at least it's stationary, but at some points I think the model go outside of it and outside of P. I don't know why. It jump. So I'm curious of why, but obviously the better one is the top one.
Exactly. So the top one, this would be like what the book refers to as a healthy Markov chain. Yeah. This one has a trend, so therefore it has autocorrelation, which is bad. We'd like to avoid that. And this one here seems to get stuck in narrow spaces and doesn't explore the full space, which is actually not great. So I guess it depends a bit, but actually chain B, that's not a good one according to the book either.
The
top one is good, and these two are that's not how we want the Markov chains to look.
Okay.
So essentially, like, I mean, you define your model, you have the data is already there. You define the parameters to the model, like which range of values they can take on, and then you define your actual model. And then you run it. And then you want to make sure, like, hey, like, okay, we have this model, we have this sort of description of reality or like whatever reality we're studying. But then like, we want to sort of know, like, hey, does what we do make sense? Like, does this seem sane? Like, can we report this to management and still keep our jobs? Because upper management is of course very, very experienced with diagnosing Markov chains, and those are the details they care about. Like if you work with the game, like, you know, yeah, could have an effect on the entire game. What you do, and if you do, I guess, clinical psychology, like, if you have robust, reliable results that show like a certain treatment is better, I guess that can save human lives potentially. And like sloppiness or a bad model that could enforce a practice that isn't really giving anything, but people think it does. So it's important to diagnose. I guess that's something that they didn't really mention, but wanted to fill in. So yeah, that's why we want to look at the Markov chains. And one thing they haven't discussed is that you can, of course, you would preferably want to generate some fake data, to see if the model actually makes sense, and not just like throw the actual data at it. Okay, and then like we've been discussing it already, but like since we run multiple chains, we want them to look similar, because if they don't, then maybe we're not approximating the posterior that well. So we have the four chains to the left, and we have the four chains to the right. So which one would you prefer your four Markov chains to look like?
Brendan, your turn.
Well, just because you mentioned it earlier that they should all sort of look similar, that I'm inclined to say the one on the left.
Exactly. Yes. 10 points, at least. More than Michael Jordan. No, that's the right answer. So, yeah. And then the second part, I mean, so essentially like a lower R hat, the better. Like R hat, they say in the book, like, you know, you want it to be as close to one as possible. And if it's, they say like as a rule of thumb, typically if it's above 1.05, then something is not the way it should. It's like something is more than right in the state of Denmark, if you've read Hamlet. So essentially how you the way you calculate R hat is that you take the variance of all the chains combined, and you divide it by the variance. No, I'm just wondering. I guess you have to pick one chain here. Like with the variance within one chain, you pick one, I guess. You take the square root of that square root of that number. So now I'm just like throwing some math in your faces. But then do you have an intuition of how, like, is there any intuition to how R hat values would relate to the looks of these chains?
Okay. Well, I think it makes sense.
Does anyone want to have a go, or do you want me to have a go?
I would like to explain the reason for the equation.
Sorry?
Like, do you want us to explain like how the equation works when you say the intuition? Like why?
No, like the intuition of the connection to these graphs and the equation. Like how they connect. Okay.
I mean,
essentially here we say we don't want the Markov chains to look like this, and we say that the variance combined with all chains within all chains, it's pretty big, right? And then if you take the variance combined, you have like at some place you have this, you know, it's quite big. And if you divide it by the difference within one chain, then the R hat is gonna be a large number, right? Because the combined variance here, it looks like it's a lot bigger than the variance of any one chain. While if you look here, it really feels like the variance within any one of these chains is, you know, it's pretty close to the variance of all the chains, which means that, you know, this like dividing the combined one with any singular one, that's a small number. That's close to one here, but it's not close to one here. And then if you take the square root of a number close to one, it's going to be closer to one than a number that's far away from one. So I guess that's sort of like the sort of intuition I thought that you could see there. Did the explanation make any sense?
Yeah, right. To the square root, to make it like, because you have variance.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably easier like to work on square variance, but yeah, it's good.
Yeah, I guess this thing that like one squared is one and stuff, but yeah. Okay, some more diagnostics, and this is the last slide. So they talk about effective sample size. So if you take the number of effective samples and divide it by n, you should get a value of at least 0.1. And in the base plot package they use in the book, you can use the NEF ratio function to get that for a model. And then like, how do you get n, the number of effective samples? Like the number of effective samples is, according to the book, an approximation of the independent samples, the number of independent samples it would take to generate the same posterior. But yeah, the book doesn't seem to say, at least so far, doesn't seem to say anything how it's calculated. So I guess that's a bit of a black box. But then on the other side, maybe I don't know how lucky I am that they didn't explain it in detail. So, but yeah. So essentially, it's a value, like you can approximate, like, okay, if we look at this model, it's a Markov chain, meaning that, you know, it, the value of each iteration in the Markov chain depends on the previous value or many previous values. So if we somehow could just, like, you know, sampling from a posterior and like independently sample, like the amount of samples needed to get, you know, the same quality posterior, that's the number of effective samples. And then you want to have a ratio between the number of effective samples and the total number of iterations you did. And as a rule of thumb, like, I mean, this is like the numerical world. So it's more like a rule of thumb. It's not absolute law, but they say it should be at least 0.1 in the book. Autocorrelation. So the correlation between each value.
I think what you, the effects, the sample size is also a measure of autocorrelation. It kind of mean like, I think an effective sample is an effect is like when you have like independent sample in the Markov distribution. So basically, like you need 9 measure to get away from the point that you started, or to the points.
Ah, okay.
This is how I understand it, but maybe I'm wrong. Like, so basically, like if you take the next point, it's obviously like totally the same. I mean, it's depend mostly of the precedent point. Then if you take the another level, it still depend. You can still correlate it to the et cetera, et cetera. And when you like take like 1 out of 10, you are like pretty sure like you are normally not anymore related to the previous points. So you have an independent point.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. Like this,
but yeah,
I think it makes sense if you worked with Markov chains before. If you haven't, I guess that's it sounds a bit like mathematics, but it does make sense.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have correlation. I mean, there's some mathematical formula for it online, mm-hmm. but essentially, like, you know, how if one thing it changes, how much does the other thing it change? Sort of, I don't know. I guess you call it elasticity if you're an economist, right?
I'm not, but yeah, I see what it is.
Isn't it sort of like, you know, the elasticity between, I don't know, corn and soda? Like if prices of corn go up by 10% and then the price of soda goes up by 10%, isn't that elasticity? Okay,
no,
anyways.
No, because like, yeah, it's autocorrelation, because like you are correlating X with the previous value of X.
Exactly. So correlation is like, if one thing it changes, how much does the other thing it changes compared to that change? And then autocorrelation would be that you have, like, you know, a series of value. And for each value, you look at the correlation between the value and the previous value.
Yes, and previous value. Yeah.
Exactly. So, I mean, if you have the values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you have an autocorrelation with a lag of 1, you would compare 2 to 1, 3 to 2, 4 to 3, and 5 to 4. Did that make any sense? Like the explanation of autocorrelation?
Yeah. At least for someone who works with autocorrelation, yes. Okay. Yeah, I'm pretty sure like you can also draw it. Like you can make like the autocorrelation like for the 10 values, and it should at one moment be stationary. Like it doesn't like, yeah.
Diagnosing a Markov chain, like the autocorrelation should generally be low, but it's sort of fine if it's in the initial relations, in the initial iterations is high and then fades off. Okay, and then the last point is that a chain with iterations go up and down, but the trend oscillates. So we could actually look at the book instead. Have a screenshot of that. What am I screen sharing, by the way?
It was good.
Okay. And you see my browser and nothing else, right? Let's see. Da, 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 da. Should I copy paste this graph? I didn't.
That's fine.
So essentially, let's see. Here it is. Like, if it looks like this, No, what happened?
I don't know. It's went back to the beginning.
I think it just zoomed in. Maybe, but I'm.
You know,
to maybe I'm becoming developers. There could be a bug in how this book is made, or it could be me like approaching grandpa stage of life.
No, I think it's a bit higher. You are on the exercise now.
Yes.
Yeah. A bit. Oh no, calculating. It's here.
So essentially, if you have this type of plot, like it oscillates, but there's a. I think it was this one. Transmitted slow mixing, exactly. If it mixes slowly, sort of like, you know, there's a, it does oscillate, but there's sort of like, you know, this wave trend to it. Then you can thin out the chain, meaning that like you take every nth sample of the chain instead of like you take every third sample or fifth or seventh, instead of using the whole chain. And they have mixed feelings about the book. It's a method that's used apparently within the Bayesian community. But like, if you do it, you should do so with care. And a personal reflection, if we talk about thinning out, is that, and this is not from the book, this is just like my personal reflection, is that, but if you have this weird looking Markov chain, instead of trying to like, you know, thin it out and like save the model to get a posterior, maybe there's a different problem. Like maybe you should have a different model or something. Maybe not something else is wrong, or maybe you need to collect more data if you work in, if you're a sociologist or something. But okay, so that was it.
Good job. It's an art chapter. It's looking like an art chapter. So yeah. No, I think good.
It's very approachable if you like. Maybe you have to read it a few times, but like if you do, it's quite approachable. So
I will definitely do it, because you know what? Next week is I proclaim it's a week off.
It's a week off. Okay.
Yeah, it's Bastille Day.
Okay.
Burning castle.
Okay. Oh, Bastille. Okay.
Bastille Day. Yes.
Like the
we take like a day a week off, but like, ooh. I mean, it's not fair, like, cause we miss three people now, so they shouldn't take week off when they are taking it now. So, but yeah
exactly. I guess
that means perfect explanation.
Yeah, like my experience with book clubs, I don't know if it goes for. I haven't done book clubs online before, but usually the drop off rate can be quite steep.
I mean, we started at 6. Come on, we cannot drop too much. Or we go down. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's okay. I'm in it for the long haul, but yeah, this group has diminished.
I will try to re-inject some power, but currently I'm busy. But yeah, I will go on the chat and cry and send kittens.
Exactly.
maybe kittens.
I will keep reading the book, but I might not be able to be back to the reading group before mid-August after this.
That's like, fine.
I'm not promising it's not for sure that I won't show up. Like if I can, I will, but I'm not in a position where I can make promises, but I'll definitely be back in August.
You know what, like I remember, like life is hard, we all have like, so it's fine, like no big deal. I will try to motivate back people. I think we'll like have subscribed to plenty of time where I will speak, so you'll probably get back. I think like Francesca, she's in a lot of book club, so maybe she's like So that's it. But yeah, you know, I will try to like put like some cats and bias stuff on the chat when I get time. So people will say, oh my God, this must be so awesome. And they will come back.
Pump it up. Oh, chapter 7 is so great. It just like makes everything we read before click into place. I love it.
Yeah, kittens. Awesome.
Let's do it, guys. Let's go to the beach. Let's go to the beach as Bayesians. Yeah,
that's it. I will draw some like shining stuff and that will work. Okay, well, okay. Thanks a lot.
And then we can model like the effect of the emojis on the attendee rate.
I'm bad with emoji, but I will try.
Okay, so we're having a meeting next week, but you won't be there, Olivier. Is that?
No, there is no meeting next week.
We're just kidding. Okay, so I'll let the group know. All right, sounds good. Because I'm presenting next week, so I have more time to catch up.
Yeah. You can do plenty of exercise, and you can also like. How do I say that? Like prepare your PhD and did you elect your advisors? Did you know your advisors?
I do, yeah.
Okay, he's nice. She is nice.
Yeah, okay, she's good. Nice.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean 95% of the PhD is picking good advisors.
Right. Yeah, that's what I've heard. But yeah, I'll be moving in the beginning of August, so I won't be busy until then.
Okay. Well, see you guys. So
21st of July it is then. Okay.
Yeah,
to make it.
Sure.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Enjoy some rest.